Welcome to the fourth lecture on heat transfer by convection. In this lecture we consider turbulent flow. The learning goals of this lecture are to understand when turbulent flow occurs and what the macroscopic effect is of the turbulent fluctuations in the velocity on the mass and the heat transport in the flow. We start by looking at the flow past a flat plate. This is indicated in the picture at the bottom. The flow is a uniform flow entering from the left. The x-coordinate is along the plate, the y-coordinate is perpendicular to the plate, and we see that above the plate the boundary layer develops as we have analyzed in the previous lectures. At the plate we have a velocity zero, the no slip condition, and at the edge of the boundary layer we are close to the velocity of the uniform flow. In the first region along the plate, we will have a laminar flow. That is, the flow is organized in straight lines, in streamlines. The question now is if the flow along the plate is always laminar. This depends on the Reynolds number that is indicated here, the product of rho times u infinity times x divided by eta. X is the location at the plate. The Reynolds number indicates the magnitude of the inertia forces versus the friction forces in the equations, in particular in the momentum equation. And when the Reynolds number becomes large, the inertia forces dominate the friction forces and the stabilizing effect of the friction forces on the flow becomes smaller. So when x increases along the plate, this Reynolds number increases. And we will see that the inertial forces, the momentum flow, can no longer be stabilized by the viscous forces. That means that small disturbances in the flow will be aggravated, and that starts the velocity variations that create turbulence. This will first happen in a transition region, and in this transition region, close to the plate, we will start to still have a boundary layer is viscous sublayer where the flow is viscous, and in the intermediate region the flow is already becoming turbulent, and further away the flow becomes more and more turbulent in the boundary layer, and the viscous sublayer will stay in place, of course, because in that area the velocities are still small, and in that area the Reynolds number is still small. Here are a few movies of a visualization of an experiment where we indicate the effect of turbulence. It's an experiment where a colored fluid is injected through a small pipe in a bath of the same fluid. The pipe is fully immersed in the fluid, and we can watch the colored fluid spread through the domain. And the speed of the injected fluid is varied, and the Reynolds number for this case is given by based on the diameter of the pipe and the speed of the velocity in the pipe. First, I play the case of a low Reynolds number. You can see here that the flow exits the pipe in a straight line in a beautiful laminar way. Then it spreads over the bottom. Near the edges of the domain, it turns upwards where there is a vortex. And we can see that the spreading is very gradual by this mechanism. If we now increase the velocity of the flow, we see a difference. We see that in the first part the jet is still straight, but then it turns turbulent. It starts to exhibit velocity oscillations, and you see that as a result of these variations the colored fluid spreads more quickly and more chaotically through the domain. If we increase the Reynolds number even further, this effect is much stronger. We see that now the jet is fully turbulent. It is no longer straight, but it is a cone-like shape with big movements inside, and we also see strong movements in the fluid that affect the spreading. We can see that the spreading of the colored fluid is much faster than it is for the laminar case all the way to the right. This is the gross scale effect of the turbulence. If we now look at the case of the laminar flow, and we have one injected streamline that we follow, then we see that this streamline is straight, and then past the bottom it gradually starts to show variations in the spreading of the fluid, And these spreading variations indicate that there are velocity variations and that the flow gradually becomes turbulent. And then it rolls up near the wall. We can also look at the flow past an object, and to understand what happens in terms of the heat transfer, we need to look at the flow past an object, and particularly we need to look at the boundary layer. First, let's look at the large-scale pattern, and this is the flow around a bird, and the photograph is originating from the University of Iowa. In the area indicated in blue, we have the free flow, and here we see velocity gradients, but not so strong, and we see that the flow follows the shape of the object quite closely, and the pressure in the flow determines the shape of these streamlines. Zooming in on the boundary layer that is indicated here in red, we see that close to the beak of the bird here, and following the bird, the flow is laminar. And then at some point, the flow transitions, the flow in the boundary layer transitions to become turbulent. And that is on the top side, but also on the bottom side. And in the next region, here we see that the boundary layer separates from the object. The object curves back, the pressure in the flow increases, and then it pushes the boundary layer away from the surface. And that is what we call separation. It's a detached boundary layer. The flow can no longer follow the contour of the body. And all this is, of course, going to affect the heat transfer and the friction in the flow. Here's another example of a sphere in the flow. This is a single moment photograph, and we see clearly that there's a boundary layer that follows the object and then it separates, and here we see the velocity variations in the wake. If we take a longer exposure time for this case, we start to see the streamlines, and we also start to see the shape of the wake. And here we can see that the streamlines smoothly curve around the sphere and then turn back, leaving a wake in which there is a lot of velocity variation. Note that we can also beautifully see the stagnation point to the left of the sphere. Now, what is a turbulent flow and how can we characterize it? First of all, the cause of turbulence is the fact that the inertial forces can no longer be stabilized by the viscous forces. That means that the Reynolds number is high. Reynolds number can be high for the flow itself, but the Reynolds number can also be high in the boundary layer along the flow, because there it is determined by the location from the inlet point of the flow. The effect is that we will have turbulent fluctuations in the flow, and they will be on top of the average flow, and this is indicated here in the graph to the left. So the velocity exhibits variations, there is an average velocity, and on top of this velocity we have fluctuations indicated by u prime. This applies to all quantities, so it applies to the horizontal velocity, the vertical velocity, it applies to the temperature, and it applies to the pressure. Again, this magnitude of the development of these velocity variations is beautifully indicated in the result of the experiment, where we have a single small line of colored flow injected, and then along the boundary layer at the bottom, we see these velocity variations develop. We can substitute this concept of the flow velocity and the flow quantities being the sum of an average and a variation in the equations, and average the equations, and that gives us the equations as they are shown here, the equation for the mass flow, the equation for the momentum flow in both directions, and the equation for the energy conservation. And we can now try to see how the variations in the velocity and in the temperature and in the pressure affect the global large-scale equations. For that, we look at the case where the average of the velocity variation is zero, and the average of the pressure variation and temperature variation are also zero. This then leads to the following equation, in which we have a few additional terms. We see that in each equation, in the momentum equation in x direction, in y direction, and in the energy equation, we have an additional term that comprises of averages of velocity derivatives of averages of velocity variations, in this case the velocity variation in u squared, and there the derivative in x direction, the product of the velocity variation of u and v, and the y derivative of it, and here we see products of the velocity variation times the temperature variation averaged, and then the derivative in x direction. And these terms, as you can see, they have the nature of the viscous terms. They are of a similar behavior. These terms we refer to as the turbulent shear stresses. And the term in the energy equation refers to as the turbulent heat conduction. What we can see is that the turbulent fluctuations on the total equations have the effect of macroscopically of diffusion. That means that we can also try to write them in exactly the same form. That is, we can write these terms as a diffusion term, that is a turbulent viscosity times the same derivative that we have here in the equations. And in the energy equation, we can write it as a heat conduction, lambda, times the same derivative of the temperature. Now, of course, there are several assumptions that we make in this process, and they are far from trivial, but I'm not going to explain those here. The main point that we here wish to make is that the effect of turbulence on the large-scale equations, the averaged equations, can be written as an effective viscosity and an effective heat conduction coefficient, where the effective viscosity is the molecular viscosity plus the turbulent viscosity, and the effective thermal conductivity is the molecular conductivity plus the turbulent conductivity. So if we now have to answer how does turbulence affect heat transfer, then turbulence leads to an increased motion in the flow and an exchange of momentum and heat. This is reflected in the equations by the additional turbulent viscosity and turbulent heat conductivity. This means that for the case of turbulent flow, we will have separate correlations for the Nusselt number as a function of the Reynolds number and the Prandtl number for the forced convection, and for the Nusselt number as a function of the Reynolds number and the Grashof number for natural convection. So to distinguish convection problems, so far we have distinguished forced and natural convection, internal and external flow, and now we also have to look at laminar and turbulent. And to predict heat transfer adequately, it is of the utmost importance that we use the right correlation for the right case. And in some of the following lectures, examples of these correlations will be given. Thank you for your attention.